when I was six, you know, I was actually able to use the voice on the computer we had at home. And, of course, you know, at that age, it's great to type out all rude words, swear words, etc., and then speak them off, you know, because I knew I'd never hear my dad saying them, so I wanted to see what they sounded like. But I felt bad a few years later because, you know, I was sort of playing with his identity in some way.
Tim's childhood games also revealed another unexpected benefit of Hawking's new voice. People found it fascinating.
The first scientific description of time was given in 1689 by Sir Isaac Newton, who held the Legation chair at Cambridge that I now occupy, though it wasn't electrically operated in his time.
Hawking himself was already memorable, but his synthesized voice made him unforgettable. His brush with death meant he now needed round-the-clock nursing, which the family couldn't afford. Jane got funding from several charitable organizations, but Hawking wanted to find a better way to provide for his family's future. He already had a plan. Just before he caught pneumonia, he'd signed a contract to write a popular book on the universe. With his computerized voice now making it easier to communicate, he resumed work on the manuscript.
I asked him about this book. I gathered it was supposed to be a sort of popular book. And I said, "Are you writing this with the Cambridge University Press?" And he said, "Good heavens, no. You're doing this to make money."
Television had already given Hawking a taste of fame. He knew the public was interested in him and his universe, and believed that a book written by him and packaged in the right way could sell to a very wide audience.
I think he knew how he was going to get a bestseller. I think his management of A Brief History was very much a measure of Stephen. I mean, he knew where, who to use, and how to get that book out.
Every publisher had to submit a letter along with their offer indicating what their publishing plan was going to be. So I wrote this letter, and in the letter, one of the things I said was that the publisher I was working for, Bantam Books, had very powerful distribution. They were very strong in putting the books out there, and that they would be able to put books, hardcover books, in places like airports. Make them widely available. And little did I know that of all the sentences in this long letter, this seductive letter, it would be that sentence that Stephen would jump on. And he loved the idea of his book in airports.
Space and time were made dynamic by the Einstein equations, which described how they were curved and distorted by the matter and energy in the universe.
Despite the complex subject matter, Hawking did all he could to make the book accessible. Yet when it was nearing completion, he began to worry whether he'd gone too far and it might not be taken seriously enough.
The title that came with the manuscript originally was A Brief History of Time. Late in the process, we were really getting close to finally putting these books to press. I got a call from Stephen saying he'd been thinking about it. He was concerned that maybe A Brief History of Time was a bit too casual, irreverent, and that perhaps we should call this book A Short History of Time. And I felt that strongly that that was not the way to go. And I quickly dashed off a note to Stephen and said, "A Brief History of Time makes me smile." And that carried the day.
The book was published in spring 1988 in a modest run of 40,000 copies. But when it was realized some of the picture captions were wrong, the publishers rushed to withdraw them from the shops.
The retailers then said, "We can't, we'd love to, but they're gone. They have been sold, they're off the shelves." And Bantam, for the first time, got the sense of, wow, we're onto something major.
The publishers were onto something major. A Brief History of Time would go on to sell 25 million copies worldwide. For the Hawking family, it changed things forever.
For the first 7 or 8 years of my life, it was, you know, a very happy setup. But, you know, the cracks only started to appear really around the time of the publication of the book.
By the late 1980s, Stephen Hawking seemed to have turned adversity to advantage. Against all odds, he'd survived motor neurone disease for more than 25 years. Now he'd written a bestseller. It seemed as if, finally, he and his family would reap the rewards of years of struggle.
We'd always got along before, but things, you know, we hadn't been especially wealthy, or we'd managed to survive. But suddenly, things started to change, and I remember around that time, that there was a Lego set that was cost about £100, and I thought that was fiendishly expensive, and I'd never have it. And the next thing I knew, my dad had bought it for me, and that was just about the time that the book was published. And so I knew that, something was changing.
But it wasn't just the family's financial status that was changing. Hawking now needed round-the-clock nursing care. A constant stream of nurses worked a rota of shifts looking after him.
It just changed things completely. You had a lot of new people coming in to the house, wandering in and out. The front door was always open. And it started to unsettle the balance of the family. My brother Robert, he was starting to go off to university. My sister Lucy, she was involved in, getting more involved in school, but she didn't feel that comfortable at home. I think my mum found it hard because nurses started treating our house as their own home. Taking baths, helping themselves to food, and our sort of house was turning into a hospital. Suddenly, Dad seemed to become a lot more outgoing with people outside the house. He was starting to let his hair down in some ways. He started buying Beatles CDs and stuff, and having parties, and the fact he could also, of course, be more independent now that he had his nurses, and that actually made his life easier, which meant that he didn't really have to be with my mum 24 hours a day. So maybe that was just a reaction. He wanted to do his own thing after having been dependent on her for so long. It was probably then that, rot was starting to set in as far as, their relationship was concerned.
I'm not an appendage of Stephen, as I very much feel I am when we go to some of these official gatherings. I mean, sometimes I'm not even introduced to people. I come along behind. And I don't really know who I'm speaking to. But with my friends, I'm just me, and that's just Jane. That's terribly important. It's terribly important for my self-respect, and terribly important for my survival, I think.
Yes, I think my mother did feel as though she'd been treated unfairly, because she'd been marginalised, really. She was no longer playing the role of my dad's nurse. And also, she wasn't really playing the role of his wife, because it was quite rare for them actually to go out together. And obviously, if they did, it would involve taking, an entourage with them as well. She just didn't seem to fit in anywhere, and I think that really made her question why she had spent so much of her life devoting herself to my dad.
I don't think I had any idea how things would turn out. It was very, very difficult to know what would happen. It was impossible to look into the future. You can't put the clock back, and you can't, and history doesn't repeat itself. So you have to say that you took the right decision at the right time.